Good morning. What a privilege it is to gather in the name of Jesus Christ and to give him praise and to affirm, if you're not a Christian, then you need Jesus Christ. If you are, then to fall in love with him all over again, because he's worthwhile in every way. He's the greatest of all. And let's stand and sing together, "I Will Trust in You."
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Father, we are so grateful, Lord, to come before you. To find a trustworthy place in this world is difficult, Lord. We know trusts have often been betrayed, Lord. But we're thankful, O God, that when you say something, you mean it. That we can rest upon the truth of your word and who you are and what you say you are to us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that it takes away, Lord, that ambiguity. It takes away, oh God, that fear. It takes away the uncertainty that life is filled with when we have an anchor for our soul in Jesus Christ. An anchor that is immovable. An anchor that has made promises that will stand sure through time and eternity. So we come to you, Lord, we say, I will trust in you. I look to you, Lord. We look to you. We give you praise and honor and glory this morning. We realize, Lord, that every good and perfect gift has come from you, and that you're the center of the universe, and we ought to keep you there in our hearts, Lord. You and you alone, we give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Once it was the blessing, now it is the Lord. Once it was the feeling, now it is His word. Once His gifts I wanted, oh, now the giver owns. Once I sought for healing, now Himself alone. All in all forever, Jesus will I sing. Everything in Jesus, Jesus everything. Once 'twas painful trying, oh, now 'tis perfect trust. Once I have salvation, and now the uttermost. Once 'twas ceaseless holding, now He holds me fast. Once 'twas constant drifting, now my anchor's cast. All in all forever, Jesus will I sing. Everything in Jesus, in Jesus everything. Once 'twas busy planning, now 'tis trustful prayer. Once 'twas anxious caring, but now He has the care. Once 'twas what I wanted, but now what Jesus said. Once 'twas constant asking, now 'tis ceaseless praying. All in all forever, Jesus will I sing. Everything in Jesus, Jesus everything. Once it was my working, is it and shall be. Once I tried to use Him, but now He uses me. Once the power I wanted, now the mighty one. Once for self I labored, but now for Him alone. All in all forever, Jesus will I sing. Everything in Jesus, Jesus everything. Once I hoped in Jesus, now I know He's mine. Once my lamps were dying, and now they brightly shine. Once for death I waited, but now He's coming in. And my hopes are anchored, safe within the veil. All in all forever, Jesus will I see. Everything in Jesus everything. All in all forever, Jesus will I sing. Everything in Jesus, and Jesus everything.
Go back a couple of slides there for me, and it says here, no, down some more. I'm looking for safe within the veil, so it's at the end, near the end. There. Once for death I waited, now is coming hail. That is the coming of the Lord, and we're going to meet Jesus. It's not just, oh, I'm going to die, that's it, it's over, but instead we see Jesus face to face. And then it says, now my hopes are anchored safe within the veil. What I like to do is make sure that everybody knows what they're singing. So why does it say safe within the veil? Anybody got an answer to that one? You can have a seat.
We're the bride of Christ.
Okay, we're the bride of Christ. So you're thinking about the veil that the bride wears, right?
Or the veil when it's torn down.
What's that? There, in the temple of the Old Testament, there was this veil that no one could get past without just the high priest could go once a year and to make a sacrifice. And that was where the very complete glory of God was. Now my hopes are anchored safe within the veil. Not the veil on earth of the old temple, but within the veil of heaven itself where God is. So that's why it says my hopes are anchored safe within the veil. Okay? Nice to know what you're saying. Isn't that a great song? It was written by A.B. Simpson, and it's just full of the reality of where a Christian should be, where Christ is all, in all, and everything to you, above what you're going to get out of the gospel. Sometimes when we first come, we're coming for what we're going to get, but then we begin to realize it's much bigger than that. We come to honor the Lord, to honor Him, to put Him first in our lives, because He's a wonderful and He's a merciful Savior. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offered hope in our hearts and hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing.
heart's always hunger for. Oh, our heart's always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offered hope when our hearts hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Amen. Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be
filled with messages from thee. Filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not my good I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose. Every power as thou shalt choose. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. It shall be thy royal throne.
Yes, give it all to Jesus. Well, let's take a few moments for a puppet show.
Well, good morning, everybody. Yeah, well, I got an important mission today. I've been trying to figure out which one of all my friends in the barnyard and other friends, which one is the greatest. And I'm thinking that we should have a competition as to who's the greatest. Because you know what? I think I'll win. Yep, I think so. Well, here comes Millie.
Hey, Millie. Lammy? I must have woke up late this morning. Lammy, did I hear you're having a competition?
Yeah. We're trying to figure out who's the greatest of all.
Oh, well, that sounds like interesting. Well, have you figured out that it's a cow yet?
Are you kidding? I make wool for the farmer and his wife and children so they can keep warm. I think that's the greatest.
Well, yes, but I give them milk so that they can drink nice milk and it's healthy for them.
Yeah, well, milk is milk, but wool is wool.
Well, I'm not sure, but anyway, I think that the cow will probably win.
Huh. Well, so much for that idea. I think that I still am the greatest. Oh, here comes Percy Pig. Hey, Percy.
Hey, hello, Lammy. How are you doing?
Well, I'm doing good.
Hey, I hear you're talking about who's the greatest.
Yeah, who is the greatest?
Well, you know pigs.
Yeah, I do know pigs.
Yes, well, we can roll in the mud better than anyone can. That counts for a lot.
Well, not with lambs, it doesn't.
Yes, and the other thing is that, well, we make ham, but I'm not going to talk about that here. But we're pretty pink.
Well, that's true. You are very pretty pink. But lambs make wool, and it keeps everybody warm.
Well, I still think that pigs are the greatest. Huh.
Oh, here comes Pinky the Flamingo.
Oh, hello.
Hey, Pinky, how are you? Good. I hear you're talking about who's the greatest. Well, you know, nobody can nod yes like I can. Well, that's for sure. I can do it either. Yes, but, and don't forget, I'm pretty pink. Okay, watch that head of yours, will you? Sure, I'll stay back a little bit, but yes, I'm pretty pink, you know. Well, so's the pig. Yes, but my pink is pinkier than his pinkier is. Whoa. Well, I'm not pink at all, but I'm white, and lambs make wool. Well, I don't make wool, but I can fly. Can you? No, I tried to fly once, but it didn't work out very good. Okay, well, I think the flamingos are the greatest.
Wow.
Well, I don't know if there's anybody else, but I think the lamb is one. The lambs is the greatest, I'm pretty sure. Everybody's going to agree with that for sure. Whoa, look what's coming.
Yes, well, hello there.
Oh, Ollie the octopus, I haven't seen you in a while.
I know, but I heard you were talking about who was the greatest.
Woohoo! Oh, Ollie, I don't want to get slimed today.
That's okay, but you know anybody else who has as many legs as I do?
No, I don't, except for maybe a bug of some kind.
Yes, but I'm not a bug. I'm an octopus.
That's true, you are.
Yes, and because I'm an octopus, and I have 8 legs, and I can squirt ink.
I didn't know that.
Yes, if somebody tries to attack me, I squirt ink on them, and they run away. I mean, swim away.
Wow, that's pretty amazing, but you don't grow any wool, do you?
No, I don't. I wouldn't want to. It would sink me into the bottom of the ocean, and I would never be able to get to the top.
I suppose that's true, but I still say that the lambs are greatest.
Oh, well, we shall see.
Well, I think it's all decided now. I'm pretty sure that the lambs are the greatest. And you know what happens? It just happens to be me. I'm trying to be impartial here. You know what I mean. I'm being a very fair judgment because wool is better than anything else. Oh, Bozier, how are you?
Well, to tell you the truth, I'm a little bit disturbed.
Wow, what's the matter? Is it getting too cold for you? Because I know you're from Africa.
Oh, no. It's very nice and comfortable, thank you very much. But what I'm concerned about is that I'm hearing everybody says that they're the greatest.
Well, yeah. Well, what makes you think you're the greatest?
I don't think I'm the greatest. I don't think anybody is the greatest.
Why not?
Because God is the greatest. And we shouldn't compare ourselves to each other.
Well, I suppose you're right. But what about wool?
Wool is good. But we don't use wool very much in Africa.
You don't?
No, it's too hot. If I put wool on, I would swim in my own sweat.
Well, I never thought of that. You mean wool is not used in lots of parts of the world?
Nope, it's not.
So I wouldn't be great there.
Well, do you know what? Everybody is great. But guess who is the greatest?
Well, I thought it was lambs, but not from what you're saying.
No, God is the greatest.
Oh, you're right.
Yes, we should thank God that he's the greatest, and we should thank God for every other person or animal, like whether it's a pig or whether it's a flamingo or an octopus. We should thank God that he is the greatest, because guess who made all of the creatures?
Well, I didn't make myself, that's for sure.
No, God made you, and God made everybody here, and we are all great in the eyes of God, but he is the greatest of all. And we should not be comparing ourselves to each other. We all need each other. God is great.
Wow. Well, that's good to remember. God is the greatest of all.
Yes, he is. God is great in Africa.
God is great in Canada. God is great in the ocean. God is great in the barn. And God is great in the church.
It's true. It's true. How did I forget that? Oh, I have to go talk to all the other animals. And I'm sorry in thinking that I was greater than them. Nobody's greater than anybody else except God.
You've got it, Lammy. That's for sure. Well, let's go get all the farm animals together, and we'll tell them together about how great God is.
Sounds wonderful.
God is great.
He is very great.
Well, let's just look to the Lord before we open up the scriptures. Father, we thank you for the Bible. We thank you for its truth. We thank you, Lord, that you can touch us in a marvelous way this morning. You can speak to us. You can, Lord, open our minds and our hearts towards you in a fresh way. That, Lord, we don't just come ho-hum and just get through a church service and go home. But, Lord, we are here to meet with the living God. We are here to experience you in a marvelous way. And we pray, Father, that you would come and touch us. You would open up our souls and you would speak into our lives. And that, Lord, the truth, Lord, would truly do that which it does best, and that is set us free. That we would know the fullness of God in our lives, that we would know your presence and your blessing. And, Lord, that you would be honored. Father, that you would increase and we would decrease. We would know what it is to experience the greatness of God more and more as each day goes by. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we come to John chapter 3, verse 22, as we are progressing through the Gospel of John. And we come to this whole area of concluding the area, pardon me, where Jesus was telling how to be born again. All of the previous section was Jesus speaking about how to come to faith in him. And praise the Lord for the clarity of that. That you can know for sure that you are born again. And if you aren't sure, then you probably aren't. But you can trust Christ today, and you can experience that new birth and the wonder of all that it entails. So after this, it says, Jesus and his disciples went into the Judean countryside, where he spent some time with them and baptized. So he left Jerusalem, goes back to Judea, where his roots were, where John the Baptist had been baptizing, and when he had met with Nicodemus, that would have been in Jerusalem, but now he's back into Judea, and he spent time with them and baptized, it says. So suddenly we read that Jesus is baptizing. We know that John the Baptist was baptizing, but now it says that Jesus is baptizing. And probably the question would arise, well, why would Jesus bother baptizing if John was baptizing? Well, we have to understand something, that the baptism that John initiated under the direction of the Spirit of God was a baptism of repentance. It was a way of saying that we want to turn from our sin. We want to be cleansed from our sin. Now, the water of the Jordan River doesn't make you cleaner than the water from Shady Camp. Though, you know, depends on what part of the harbor you're in, but it's not the water that makes the difference in baptism. It is the heart. God looks on the heart, and for John the Baptist, he was calling people and saying, "You need to repent," and that expression of repentance was the water baptism. But the baptism that Jesus began to do, and that we discover clearly in the end of Matthew's gospel, that it was a baptism that was in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. This was a baptism that expressed something more than just repentance, but it expressed salvation. And there's a difference between the two. You can have a heart that says, "I want to turn from sin," but you need more than that. You need a heart that turns to Jesus. Because even if you're willing to turn from sin, you need a Savior. The Apostle Paul said in the book of Acts, as he spoke to the Ephesian elders, he said, "I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God." And then he lists what that whole counsel was. It was two things. One was repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. And so lots of people are sorry because they've done something wrong. But being sorry is not enough. If being sorry was enough, Jesus wouldn't have had to die for your sins. If being sorry was enough, then it would actually change people's lives. But how many people have said, I'm sorry, and then turn around and do the same thing again and again and again and again? And so, yeah, being sorry is not enough. It's like, you know, a man is drowning, or maybe he's, you know, lived a terrible life, and suddenly, you know, he's going to drown. He says, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. And then suddenly a life raft comes and picks him up, and by the next day he's back to his old ways. That's not what God wants in your life. He wants a repentance that leads to change, and the only way that change can happen is by putting your faith in Jesus. So John the Baptist was giving a preparatory baptism. And you'll actually discover later on in the book of Acts, there were followers of John the Baptist who had been baptized with John's baptism when Paul met them. And he said, what have you been baptized to? Oh, John's. So he said, no, you need Christ. And he explained the gospel to them. They trusted Christ and they were baptized afterwards. Okay, so John's baptism was a passing baptism. It was a temporary baptism. It was only present to prepare the way for Jesus. Now the baptism that Jesus initiated and that was continued by the disciples and continued down through the years is a baptism of declaration. It's a baptism that says, I have died to my old way of life and I have risen to a new way of life. And I want you to know that baptism was by immersion. It was not by taking a baby and sprinkling it. And there is not one record of any baby baptized in the Bible. Babies don't know what's going on. And you could take a little baby and you could sprinkle water on one and not sprinkle water on the other. And I can tell you it's not going to make any difference in how they live. Not a particle of difference. So baptism was taking place here, but Jesus was baptizing. But then we discover in John chapter 4, jumping ahead just for a second, because it says, however, Jesus did not baptize, but he had his disciples baptizing. Okay? So Jesus never personally baptized anybody. Probably because someone might get it in their head, well, who baptized you? Jesus baptized me. You know, we're prone to that, aren't we? We're prone to self-elevation. So it would have avoided all of that idea, because baptism in itself does not save you. Baptism in itself does not make you a Christian. And that is another fallacy that is often out there. Well, as long as, you know, somebody gets baptized in a church, that makes them a Christian. No, it doesn't make you a Christian. What makes you a Christian is faith in Jesus Christ. That's what makes you a Christian. So, now John also was baptizing. So Jesus and his disciples were baptizing, and John also was baptizing at Aenon near Salem, because there was plenty of water and people were coming and being baptized. So John was still continuing his ministry while Jesus had begun his ministry. There was an overlap between the two. And I want you to notice something just to show you that it wasn't sprinkling. He went there because what? There was plenty of what? Water there. Now, if you're just pouring water on top of somebody, do you need plenty of water? No, you don't. All you need is a cup full, right? But no, he made sure he was in a place where there was plenty of water so what? He could immerse people so that they could get the full expression of a dying to an old way of life and rising to a new way of life. That's what baptism expresses. And so that was the case. Because John had not yet been thrown into prison, because it wasn't going to be long now that John was going to be arrested by Herod, and eventually he would lose his life. And so he was still ministering, and that's one thing you can see with John. He didn't stop doing what God called him to do. He kept doing it until he couldn't do it anymore. And let me encourage you to do the same. Live for Jesus with all your heart, with all your soul, with all of your passion. But here's what happens. There arose a dispute between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purification. So some of John's disciples got in an argument with some of the Jewish rulers, and they began to have this discussion, or argument, shall we say. A dispute is more like an argument than a discussion. And I think the Jews, they had ceremonies of purification, and they probably thought that, well, the baptism is just a new ceremony of purification, and they were having an argument with John's disciples about, you know, what are you doing here? And on top of that, they probably said to him, they came to John, so the disciples came to John and said,
Rabbi, he was with you beyond Jordan, to whom you testified. He's baptizing, and all are coming to him. So the Jews probably said, hey, you know, John's baptism couldn't have been good enough because now Jesus is baptizing, so what's going on here? And so they said, Jesus is baptizing? We got to go talk to John about this. Because these were still followers of John, but they had not yet seen who Jesus really was. And so they come to him, and they say, Rabbi, he was with you beyond Jordan, to whom you have testified. They heard him say, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's baptizing, and everybody's going to him. So they were upset. They didn't like that. They said, John, we're following you. This guy, I know you kind of, you know, you recognize him, you testified of him, but now he's baptizing. What's going to happen to us? What's going to happen to our movement, John? They're all coming to him. Now, it's probably an exaggeration because these guys hadn't come to him yet. But you know how it is. They were concerned. You know, they were thinking, John's building a nice little empire here. It's looking good. Growing. Movement's growing, John, and we're with you in it. Oh, this guy seems to be taking over. What are we going to do, John? John answered this. A man can receive nothing unless it has been given to him from heaven. This is such a profound statement, and it is profound for everything in life, not just this circumstance. You have not gotten anything unless it's come from heaven. How do I know that? Because God made all things. Because God made you. You didn't bring yourself into existence. And you shouldn't be puffed up about the fact that you're here. You shouldn't think that you're the greatest, because you're not. Because you can receive nothing unless it's been given to you from heaven. Unless God gives, you get nothing. You realize whatever you own can be taken away in a moment. You realize your very life can be taken away in a moment. Every possession, every hope, every dream is all temporary and contingent upon the mercy and the grace of God. You can receive nothing except to be given from heaven. So why would I boast as if I didn't receive it? Why would I think how important I am because, oh, God's given me a voice. God's given me a gift of preaching. And I know that he has done that. But should I boast about that? Should I say, look, what a good boy I am? Should I? Or should I say, God, you've given this gift, and it's your gift, and I honor you for it, not honor myself. So John's answer, what he does is as they are clamoring and saying, you know, this guy, they wouldn't even name Jesus. They said, this one whom you promoted, now he's taking over. And he says, listen, I can receive nothing unless it's given me from heaven. I am only going to do what God has given me to do, and I will receive that and live in that. I'm not the Christ. He said that earlier when they came and asked him, are you the Christ? Are you the Christ? He said, no, I'm not the Christ. I'm the one who comes before him. I'm not the Christ. And so I can't take that position. I'm not going to take a glory position. I'm not going to start the church of John the Baptist. I'm not going to do that, he says. It has to come from heaven. Oh, how good it would be that each one of us would humbly realize everything that is right and good has to come from heaven. And if we would appreciate that and give God the glory for it and look to him daily, Lord, what would you have me to do? And not step out and think you're going to do this, that, or the other, even if you think you're going to do it for God. There's many a minister that has fallen a long ways because they thought they were going to do great things for God instead of trusting a great God to do great things for his glory. We need the Lord. And John the Baptist had a humility about him that we'll see that as we continue here. He says, you yourselves bear me witness. You know that I said, I am not the Christ, but I've been sent before him. He said, my position, what's been given me from heaven, is that I come and be a witness for Christ. My purpose is to point to Jesus. It's not to point to myself. It's not to grow an empire. And I will say that churches and ministries that begin to build empires have gone in a bad direction. Instead of for the glory of Jesus Christ alone, to honor him and to praise him, that somehow event of ministry, often preachers, and you know, we're in a precarious place because pride is there lurking in everybody's life, isn't it? It's not hard for it to come out. And there's a pride that wants everybody to notice you if they don't. And if they do, then you want everybody to notice you even more. And so it's a deadly evil. It's a deadly sin. It goes before a fall. Thank you. Yeah. Pride goes before a fall. And it does. And so I have to watch my own heart and say, Lord, I'm here. I'm serving you. And my position is to serve and to lift up the people of God and to glorify the name of Jesus. It is not for my glory. It is not for myself. And it cannot be. And by the mercy of God, I keep looking to him that what I do and why I'm here before you today is to point to Jesus Christ, that I would be like John and I would say, I can receive nothing except to be given me from heaven. That would be my heart. But that would be each one of our hearts. That we would be not looking for the praise of others, but that we would be looking to praise God instead. Praise the Lord. He'll look after you. He'll look after you. Look to Jesus. If you want to find your assurance, you want to find your self-worth, you will not find it by puffing yourself up and trying to look better or be more important than anybody near you. That is not the pathway of self-assurance and real life. The real pathway is to understand that God loves you and that you're special because God loves you, even if everybody else hates you. Because you know how fickle it can be? Everybody thinks you're wonderful until something goes south or whatever. Or you say something, maybe you didn't do the right thing or say the right thing, or maybe somebody misconstrued it, and all of a sudden the ones who loved you so much have turned their backs. Don't put your confidence in the praise of people. Put it in where it belongs, and that is in the deep, rich, and wonderful love of God. You yourselves bear me witness. I said, I am not the Christ. I've been sent before him. And then he uses an illustration, a beautiful illustration. He says this, he who has the bride is the bridegroom. Now that makes sense, doesn't it? Now, this crazy culture that we live in now, who knows? But I know what the biblical marriage and definition of marriage, there's a bride and there's a bridegroom, okay? And I believe that's safe ground, that's biblical ground, and it's biological ground. So we have a bride and we have a bridegroom. But then there's the friend of the bridegroom that we would call the best man. Thank you, that went right out of my head. There's the best man. Now, can you imagine being at a wedding and, you know, the bride is here, the groom is there, and everybody's looking at them. Oh, look, they look so wonderful. They look so beautiful. And they're looking in each other's eyes and, you know, starry-eyed and tears are falling and everybody's hearing their vows. And then, you know, the best man is over on the side here and he says, so suddenly, the best man wants some attention. And so he jumps out in front and does a little dance or whatever. Would you say there's something wrong with that? Would you say, that's nuts? That's not his job. What is the best man's job? What is it?
To serve.
His job is to help the bridegroom in everything that's getting done. He's the friend. He's the one that comes alongside. And so the attention should all be on the groom and the bride. Isn't that right? That's where the attention belongs. It shouldn't go anywhere else. So John is saying, I'm like the friend of the bridegroom. And so what do? I'm here to serve. Because the Bible gives a picture. Here's what the Bible gives a picture of. That God is the bridegroom. And the people of God who trust in him are the bride. So
The Bible actually says you're like the bride of Christ. And here's the bridegroom, Jesus. And so John says, my job is to point to the bride and the groom, to keep them at the center of it all. So he has the bride as the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. And there John says, I rejoice greatly in the bridegroom's voice. I delight in the bridegroom, who is the picture here is Jesus. He says, I'm the friend, but I delight in his voice. I delight in him. And my friend, that ought to be, this is a great example. John is a great example here that you ought to delight in Jesus Christ. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me and I give them eternal life. Do you delight in Jesus? Or have you even discovered who Jesus really is? Because when you discover who he really is, suddenly he becomes beautiful. But if he's not beautiful to you, if you have no desire for him, then let me encourage you that you need to come a long ways yet. You need to say, yes, Lord, I need to trust you as my Savior. Because when you actually receive him as your Savior, when you know your sin, and when you see what he's done for you, and you receive him into your life, and your sins are all forgiven, suddenly you begin to fall in love with Jesus. You're falling in love with somebody who you didn't even know before. You knew of him, but you didn't know him. And it changes everything. You see, Christianity is a love relationship with God. John the Baptist doesn't say, oh, I heard his voice, and I thought, oh, I'm going to have to go and serve him. No, he said, I delight in the bridegroom's voice. I delight in him. Do you delight in Jesus Christ? Do you rejoice greatly because Jesus Christ is speaking into your life and into your soul? Because the word of God grows in your heart and you begin to discover who God really is? Are you delighting in him? Are you rejoicing in the Lord? We ought to be a people who are filled with hearts of rejoicing. Yes, we have plenty to grieve about in this world. Yes, there are trials around us. There are troubles before us, and there are people that are hurting and broken, and we weep with them, and we look for them. We try to help them. We lift them up. But listen, Christianity is a living and loving relationship with God, and we were meant to hear the bridegroom's voice. We were meant to hear what God has to say and to rejoice in him and to know his presence in our lives every single day. Therefore, this joy of mine is fulfilled. John says, I'm fulfilled here. You don't have to promote me. John's disciples, come on, John. Let's get busy here. You know, Jesus is winning. He says, no. I'm not winning here. My joy is fulfilled being in the presence of Jesus. I don't have to climb some ladder. My friends, you don't have to climb any social ladder. You don't have to climb some church ladder. You don't have to do any of those things in order to really live. Real life is in this incredible relationship with Jesus Christ. If you miss that, it all becomes politics, doesn't it? And listen, religion is full of politics. It's full of who's nicer or better or greater than somebody else. May it not be so here among us, but may it be among us that we are always looking to honor Christ first and to serve one another with our whole hearts, to be serving. John the Baptist was serving Christ and serving the church. That's what you should be doing. That's what God's called you to do. It's what he's called me to do, to serve Christ and serve one another. And so John says this in John 3:30, he must increase, but I must decrease. Now, in actual reality, that's what needed to happen. John had to fade off the scene of history, and Christ had to take center stage. He must increase, and I must decrease. But in another sense, that must happen among all of us. Your pride and your ego and what you think you are, all of that needs to kind of just disappear. And instead, Christ needs to rise up in your life, in your heart, in your thinking, in your ways. And it's radical. It really is. That's why some people won't come to Jesus, because Jesus is saying, you need to die to yourself, and now you need to live for me. Oh, man, who are you going to do that for? I mean, if somebody came along and said to you,
just an ordinary Joe or Fred or Pierre, came and said to you, okay, listen, if you really want to live, you need to just shut your whole life down here and then do whatever I tell you. What would you say about that? You'd immediately say, that's a cult. That's not right. And of course it wouldn't be right. No pastor, preacher, leader of any group has any right to do that to anyone. It's wrong. But does Jesus have that right? Yes, he does. He created you. He knows what's best. He knows everything about you. Why wouldn't I trust him with my life and my future? Why wouldn't I trust him with the direction that I need in my life and experience? He must increase and I must decrease. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, the Bible says, and he will do something. He will lift you up. There'll be a proper lifting when Jesus lifts you up. It will be a joyous lifting. And it'll be a lifting of praise and glory and honor to Christ. And it will be a life of growth and love and humility and all the fruit of the Spirit growing and exploding in your life so that your motives will be pure in reaching out and in loving others. So John goes on and he says, he who comes from above is above all. He who is of the earth is earthly and speaks of the earth. So who's of the earth here? Pardon? We are. And John was too. He says, the one who comes from above is above all. And who's that? Jesus. John knows where he came from. He comes from above. He said, I come from the earth. He said, there's no comparison here. I speak of the earth. He who comes from heaven, he's above all. He speaks of heaven. Why would I want to exalt myself when Jesus is the one to be exalted? Why should I lift myself up and say I'm Mr. Important when it's Jesus who is most important of all? There's no comparison between Christ and us in this respect. He is the God of the universe. And what he has seen and heard, that's what he says here, Jesus, what Jesus has seen and heard, that's what he testifies, and no one receives his testimony. Now, this is a statement that John makes, it's similar to what Jesus said in John chapter 3, when he was speaking to Nicodemus, he said, you're not listening, you're not hearing my witness. And in a sense, that it was true. The people were not receiving the witness of Jesus. Are you? Have you received the witness of Jesus? Because he who has received his testimony, the testimony of Jesus, certifies God is true. Something happens when you trust in Christ. Suddenly, you begin to see God is true. God is right. God is just. God is holy. But when you do not receive his testimony, remember what I said last week. People would sooner stay in the dark if they want to keep on sinning. They don't want to come to the light. I used the example of a cockroach, didn't I? The cockroach, as soon as the light comes on, scurries for the dark. If you're not going to receive the testimony of Christ, you'll run for the dark. You'll go to the dark. But I want to encourage you, receive the testimony of Christ. God is true. For he whom God has sent speaks the words of God. For God does not give the Spirit by measure. The Father loves the Son, has given all things into his hand. And so now we have John giving clear explanation to these folks, his followers, and saying, listen, I'm nothing compared to Jesus. I'm going to decrease, he's going to increase, and he should, because he's come from heaven, because every word that he speaks is true, and the words that he speaks are from God Almighty. And the Spirit of God is upon him in unlimited measure. There is no measure to the presence and the power and the person of the Holy Spirit upon Jesus. John is giving that comparative statement saying, whoa, Jesus is higher than the heavens. Compared to me, it's just no comparison here. Don't follow me, follow Jesus. And how that ought to be, every preacher should never be pointing to themselves. They shouldn't be. It shouldn't be about them. It should be about Jesus. Later on, as the Corinthian church began to grow, there began to be arguments among them. And some of them said, oh, Apollos, he's a great teacher. Oh, well, I follow Paul. He's a better teacher. And they began to become divisive over who they were following. Most denominations have come somehow from that kind of poison, where people are trying to exalt themselves, exalt their ministries. And all the while, it should be Jesus that is lifted up. Oh, lift him high. Praise him. He is worthy. All things are in the hands of Jesus Christ. All authority is given to me, Jesus said, on heaven, in heaven and on earth. He has done everything and done it well. I mean, he was with the Father before the worlds began, and he owned everything already. He made everything already. And yet mankind was given a choice, and they chose to turn their backs on God. They chose to rebel against God, listen to the devil, and as a result of that, the human race fell. And Jesus, with all of his authority and power, could have wiped out the human race and said, that's enough. But no, he said, I love mankind, and I will redeem them, but it will be at a tremendous cost. And so he comes down to earth, and he goes into the cross, he dies for our sins, and there at the cross, Christ buys us back out from under Satan, so that he restores that which was broken. And as we yield to him, we discover his fullness of his love and his authority in our lives. Everything is in the hands of Jesus. You're going to face Jesus. People may run into the dark. People may try to hide from Christ and go off in their sin and think, oh, I've gotten away from him. I don't need to hear that. But every human being will face Jesus Christ. And now he has come to be your Savior, but then he will come to be your judge. So trust Christ. Come to Jesus, because he has all that authority. Why wouldn't you come to him now and accept him as your Savior, so that on the day of judgment, he will say to you, enter into the joy of the Lord. Because if you do not trust Christ now, you will not have him as your Savior then. There'll be no place to hide then. No rock to crawl under. As a matter of fact, in the book of Revelation chapter 6, it tells us when the end comes, that every person, great men, captains, strong men, will cry for the rocks and the hills to fall on them. Listen, this is what it says in the book of Revelation, to fall on them, to hide them from the face of him who sits upon the throne, for the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? But no rock will hide. No shelter from the great storm of judgment will be there. The only shelter from the storm of judgment for sin that God will pour on this world that is reeking with its sin and wickedness, the only shelter is Jesus Christ. And he will save anyone who comes to him. All things are in the hands of the Father. And that is why John concludes with this verse in John 3:36 in this discourse that he gives to his disciples that the Holy Spirit knew that we needed to hear. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. But he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath, the anger of God abides on him. Now the word abide is rests upon him. And so the reality is, as you go through this world, if you do not put your trust in the Son, and remember the word believe is not just knowing that it's true. He already said the devil knows it's true. It's not enough to know it's true. You need to trust in the Son. If you do not put Christ as the Savior of your life, then what's happening as you're walking through the world, the anger of God is hanging over you because of your sin. And eventually that anger will fall. But God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, because he loves us. He must be angry at sin. He must be. Aren't you angry at sin when you see what it produces in someone's life? Don't you get angry if a little child is abused by someone? Doesn't that burn you and boil you? How much more the righteous Son of God, when he sees the wickedness of every sin, and that is the smallest sin that you think means, poof, oh, that's nothing. God looks at it and said, it is the most horrible thing in the universe because it poisons and destroys and spreads like a cancer. So he must have full wrath on sin. But he so loved the world that he gave his son Jesus. And here everything has been given into the hands of Christ. He has the authority to come and to come and rescue us. Nobody else has that authority. Nobody else could do it. And so he comes and he meets the wrath of God at the cross. So the wrath of God comes and the mercy of God comes and they meet there. And there the wrath of God is dissolved because it fell on his son. It won't fall on you. That's not that complicated. Because he who believes in the Son has what? Everlasting life. But he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. That is so plain, and it is so real, and so true. These are the words of the Bible. I don't make anything up. I try not to. If I do, come and tell me, please. This is what God says. And there's how John finishes up that discourse. He wants us to understand. The Spirit of God wants us to know, I need Jesus. John the Baptist was great, but I need Jesus. You have a religion, so what? You need Jesus. Religion won't do it. I don't care what the name of it is. It's not about a religion. You have a code to live by. I have my code to live by. It won't do. You need Jesus Christ. You need someone to pay for your sins. So most of the major religions of the world have a code. And most of those codes are not that bad. They're pretty good. And some people say, well, Christianity and, you know, Muslim and Jews, you know, most of the Buddhists, they all seem to have a code. And that's really, they have all that in common. That's good enough. It's not good enough. It isn't good enough. What's good enough is Christ dying for your sins, rising from the dead, saving you from the judgment of God. That's what's good enough. Nothing else will do. So don't scurry and run from God now. Because you'll try to run on the last day, but there'll be no place to hide. Come to Jesus now. Discover he is the greatest of all. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. Realize I need to trust Christ and I need him now. And he will receive you. That's the wonder of it. No matter what you've done, no matter what path you've walked on, immediately there is mercy and full pardon, forgiveness, and eternal life. He must increase. No wonder. He's the Son of God. All glory to Jesus. Honor him, praise him, give him the glory that he deserves. Amen. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, that shadows a dry thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. Oh, wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. With
numberless blessings. Each moment he crowns, and filled with his fullness divine. I sing in my rapture, oh glory to God, for such a redeemer as mine. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, and shadows a dry thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand. And he covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand. Amen, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Matthew.
Father God, we are just amazed at the mercy and grace that you have showed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus, to think that you humbled yourself to come down and to walk the life that you walked, and you went to the cross for our sake, to die for our sins. Lord God, that is everything to us. The cross is everything. And then you didn't stay in the grave, but you rose again on the third day, and you are in heaven as Lord and God. Jesus, you are our Savior and our Lord. And Lord, we just praise you today. We close this service. We ask that you'd be with us. You'd help us look to you, Jesus. We ask that you'd bless this food and be with us today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.